Hi everybody, Erica here with Fibers and Floss Canada. I want to thank everybody for returning viewers as well as welcome to any new viewers that may be joining us today. I have done quite a few videos at this point, quite a few, but maybe 10 videos or something, seems like a lot to me. And I thought I'd just do a little recap for anyone who is new and joining us. My name is Erica, I live in British Columbia in Canada, very close to Vancouver. I've been stitching for about 30 years and I love to stitch a variety of things, whether that is mainly cross stitch at this moment. I also knit, I do needlepoint, I do sewing, and then I dabble in other things such as ceramics and you name it. I love anything creative. The reason why I stitch is really for meditative purposes and having a creative outlet. I do feel a lot better when I am stitching and creating. I've done a video, I think, maybe about video 7 or something, that does talk to why it actually feels so good when we make something productive with our hands. So if you're interested in learning why it feels so good to stitch, you can go watch that. I can link it above here for you if you like. But I definitely do get a lot of meditative purposes out of that. Now, in looking at what I have done so far on my Flosstube, I think it's a really good time to kind of change up the structure a little bit. I've really loved what I've been doing, but there's a few things that mean a lot to me that I want to incorporate a little bit more and on a regular basis in my floss tubes. So the first thing I want to do is share something new that I've started, and today I started something called Flosstubeversity. So this is a very short video that I'll be doing, you know, every couple weeks. The idea is about 10 minutes or less, where you will get to watch a video and learn a little something more about the skills required for stitching. And also maybe some history or something incorporated in there. I was really inspired by watching Karen Combs' studio. This lady's fantastic. She's a very well-known quilter. She teaches quilting, and then she also has cross-stitched throughout her life as well. And she's been doing a floss tube now for about the last year. And what I really enjoy about her videos is every time I watch her video, I have to sit down with, you know, a book and pen and paper, and I think, oh, I need to write that down, and if I didn't, you know, oh, I should have known better, I should have brought something with me, because she always shares something that is really interesting and informative on all of her videos. And I'm that type of person where I do want to learn some more techniques, some more history, just always looking to try things that are a bit different that I haven't tried before, you know, broaden that skill set. So Flosstubeversity is my way of doing that and sharing that with you guys. I've had a lot of viewers ask for tutorials on things, so I'll do that via that as well. Our last video, Samantha, the Huga Stitcher, and I started a sal, hashtag #yearofthedragonsal, and I'll talk about that in a bit. But one of the things we talked about in our last video was the selvage edge of our fabric, and whether or not, you know, we've heard that selvage edge needs to be on the left of our stitching, and neither of us are really sure why that is. What's the history behind there? Does it really need to be to the left? Because there's a lot of times I've stitched, I really have no idea where my selvage edge was. It could have been at the left, maybe, you know, I have no idea. So I kind of dove into that. And the very first Flosstubeversity is all about the selvage edge and when it is important to have it at a certain orientation with respect to what you are stitching. I will attach the link here. If you guys are interested, you can check it out there, or it will also auto-populate at the end of this video and in our description box as well. So I recommend checking it out, but if you're not interested in that, just move along. You don't need to watch it. Now, I didn't stitch very many things this time because of, I actually had not one but two new starts, and I really focused a lot of my time on our hashtag #yearofthedragonsal. So maybe I'll start with that. Just a really quick recap, because there's already a whole playlist on this and there's a lot of information out there. But February the 10th was Lunar New Year. Samantha the Huga Stitcher and I've decided to host a sal for that. And so the guidelines for the sal are, it's any stitching any pattern of your choosing with a dragon in it, and it can be by any designer, any size, and it doesn't matter, whatever you like, as long as there's a dragon in it. You can join us at any time. It will run for the full year. And to participate, just make sure in your postings you're using hashtag yearofthedragonsal. We will be doing more videos for it. We will have some giveaways and exciting projects as well that we will talk about. So this year my selection was Teresa Wentzler's Celestial Dragon. And it's actually quite a fun, my lighting is not the best today, I'm sorry you guys. It's quite a fun stitch. It is, you know, with a Wentzler, it's a lot of blended threads, but it's not too intimidating. I'm also tackling her peacock tapestry right now, and that one's a little bit more complicated, I must say. So I'll show you where I got to. I did work on this for, I guess 10 days, and not every single day, although almost every day. You know, if there was a day I'm working, I'm not stitching at all because I tend to work 16 hours. Doesn't leave any time for stitching. So this is where I'm at. I've also chosen to stitch this on, they called for 28 count, but I chose a Christmas red, and I think, oh, the shadows are terrible. You know what? I'm gonna pause for a second and I'm gonna grab a different light. Just one second, I'll be right back. Okay, sorry about that. Now I'm blinded by this very bright light, so hopefully I do okay, but I'm sure the cross stitch will look fabulous. Here I am. This is about 10 days, maybe altogether 7 solid days of stitching. You can see some of the blending filament in there, sparkles a little bit. It's been a really fun stitch so far. I am missing one color. You can kind of see up on the bridge between the eye and then as well as throughout the neck, which is crazy because I've bought colors for this twice, I think, and I'm still missing one somehow. Now there are some considerations because this particular one was supposed to be stitched on white fabric. So, you know, his eye was normally a void, but a void on this fabric would be red. So I chose to add some white DMC. I think the B5200 is what I chose for his eye. And then you'll see there's some beading spaces as well in the blue corners there. So I'm pretty happy with that. It's really the page, there's 4 pages in the pattern. There's a break here and then a break right about here. So I'm almost half done the page. My goal is actually to complete this project by the end of the Lunar New Year. So that means, you know, 1 page every 3 months, and it sounds like I'm ahead of the game on that, but truly I'm not. You know, a Teresa Wentzler, you stitch the entire project and then you have the entire project to stitch again with back stitch, and I think there's like 1300 beads just on the background of this one, never mind some of the beads in the border as well. So there's a fair bit of work still to do on that one for sure, more than one may think. So that is my hashtag yearofthedragonsal. And it's really cool. If you're thinking of starting that, check out the hashtag. There are hundreds of people that have started to participate in this. I'm just blown away at the amount of people that jumped on board with this. You guys are all so amazing. And the patterns people are coming up with and fabric choices and floss choices is just, it's truly incredible. So if you're looking for, you know, to be enabled on yet another project, definitely highly recommend checking out that the hashtag. You will see projects you never even knew had existed, and there's some really great options. The second project here, which was a new start for me, is something that I had purchased in the fall, I think. I can't remember when exactly, but it's Inspired by Nature, and this is by Quaint Rose Needle Arts. I purchased this pattern because it offered 2 things I've never done before. So in looking at the larger one here, it's actually sewing 2 pieces of linen together. And then there's some applique as well down below here with the butterfly and the stick bug. So I really need to make sure what that's called. I think it's a stick bug. I'll have to Google it for next video. So I thought it did introduce a couple new skills, and I don't know I don't think there's any specialty stitches in this one. So anyways, I got to start on that. And for this one here, I'm using, they called for floss and fabric. There's two types of fabric here. So the first one's Duxbury, and I'll just show it with some of the flosses here. And these are all mainly gentle, the gentle art. And there is some classic color works in there too. Oh, I should organize those better. I haven't really started to organize that. And then the fabric is 40 count Duxbury by Fox and Rabbit, and also 40 count Seaweed. Now the called for was 36 count, but I couldn't get 36 at the time. Only 40 was available. Since then I have started this, I've posted and shared it, and quite a few people have been able to order the pattern and start it as well. And we do know that Kitten Stitcher, she does have the 36 count Duxbury and Seaweed both in stock from Fox and Rabbit. So I've recommended that people go there. Here's my start so far. So I have, it looks a bit wobbly, but I just haven't really pinned it super tight. But I did, you know, first let's talk about the linens. You have to sew two pieces together, and I had never done that before. So I did look at the a couple different tutorials for that, and I found, I'll insert some pictures while I'm speaking here. I found it to be intimidating initially, but a lot easier than you think. Essentially what you're going to do is create a running stitch where you're going up, down, up, down, up, down through both sides of your fabric, but the most difficult part is you actually need to line up each hole, because as you can see here, if I go close enough maybe, you will be stitching, those red stitches are just decorative, but in here you actually, here on the side, you stitch right over top of those pieces of linen. So it's actually really important that it is lined up correctly, and that did take a little bit of time. What I did notice that in lining this up, you know, there is some variation in all linen. It depends on what the linen base is, if it's the same supplier or not. And then also when you dye or do an overwash with the linens, it can also shrink the linen a little bit as well. So I did notice that the seaweed color and the white color, I did stitch the size of the board plus another couple inches past the board on each side. And throughout all of that, which is probably 15 inches, there were two more green threads than white. That's it. So what I ended up doing here in the decorative red line is that I think about here and about here, I did fudge. Instead of going over four threads on the bottom, I went over only three. And that makes my red line, those stitches look really quite uniform and straight. I just have to remember that while I'm stitching from the top side, everything I can landmark off the red X's. However, when I get to the white side, I cannot landmark off those red X's. I will have to landmark off the red border on the side here and come this way, because I will essentially, by the time I get to this side, be off one whole stitch, which I'm fine with. This has actually been really fun. It was really good to stitch that, and it also, I'm impressed. Like I'll insert some close-up photos for you guys, but you cannot see where these were sewn together. I think it's also important to note that it's smart to choose, when you're doing a darker and a lighter fabric, to choose the lighter color floss thread. I just used my Orafil like sewing thread that matched. I used their basic like cream colored one and use that. So if you do pull the fabric really taut on the hoop, you will see a teeny bit of that light orophyll thread. But when it's not crazy stretch, it's just stretched a little bit, you don't see anything at all, which is great. So like I was saying, you do that running stitch all the way across, and some people do leave it like that. I did choose to take that running stitch and stitch in the opposite direction all the way back again. So when you do end up with one stitch going up and down like this, the other side would come up and down the other way. So you would end up with it being basically interlocked and nice and strong. So really enjoying that stitch. I will do a Flosstubeversity on that as well, because I think that's a really cool skill to have. Yeah. Now I only have two other things to show you, and I'll go quite quickly on those because you've seen them before. This one here is the Dimensions. It's a three pack called Sweet Christmas Ornaments. Now I did fully finish, no, I did finish all the backstitch on the second ornament there. So it's ready to be fully finished now. And I'm going to do the Vonna Pfeiffer method for that with the three layers of foam board, but I'm going to wait to finish this one. And when this one's done, I'll finish the two of them together. I was trying to stitch 100 stitches a day on this, but then I started my Inspired by Nature, and I haven't stitched on this since. So my goal still is to do one ornament per month. And so I only have the next 9 days to, I guess, 8 days, February short, to finish that ornament. So I better get stitching on that one. And the last thing I've been stitching on as well is I wanted to put some stitches in a very old whip of mine. And I've been working on this stitch, not actively, but I've had it since 2014. And that's something my girlfriend Samantha and I started together years ago on vacation at my parents. And she's long since finished it and I have not. And that is Tree of Hope by Mirabilia. This one here, I am stitching it on the called for 32 count natural brown linen by Witchelt. And then I am using the called for DMC floss, as well as there's lots of blending filament and beads in this one here. Oh, and there's some Karen water lilies as well. So, oh, I gotta bring this board all the way across the screen very quickly for you guys. Sorry about that. Here I am. So I will actually, you know what, let me insert a picture. No, I won't insert a picture. I won't bother. Where I was previously is I didn't have any of this dress done. It was just, I had worked down the tree, I'd done the bee and the flower at the bottom. And now this time here, I've added on the portion of the dress. And so that is, the very top is DMC floss, and the bottom where you see the variegated colors is actually the Karen water lily silks. Now, their variegation pattern in their silk is very, very long. And so it's a bit challenging. You know, when I look at it, I do much prefer the variegation in the other skirt, how it goes lighter to darker. And I do remember when I stitched that I did, I was quite aware of how my colors were kind of playing out, and this one, not so much. Maybe I'm not changing it. I don't know. I'm happy with it though so far. My plan is to wrap up the, maybe I won't wrap up the dress. I might dive into her skin. We've talked about this before, where the skin I chose to do one over one, and I can kind of see on the other girl. It's challenging. So it ends up being like a 64 count, and the DMC is just, it's even one strand is just too thick for that really. But I will do it because it needs to match the other side. So I'll probably dive into that, and then I'll wrap up the dress, which is quite easy, enjoyable stitching. I came back to this actually for comfort stitching, and it actually had me looking up different Mirabilias that are out right now, and you know, what's the next one I should be ordering. And to be honest, I really prefer a lot of Nora Corbett's older stuff, and some of the ones I really, really like are out of print, so I'm not sure what I'm gonna do there. But I don't have I've got a couple kitted up that I can work from home, but I just wanted something with that nice big block comfort stitching, you know, so I'm not sure what I'm gonna do there. But I have a lot on the go. I don't need anything new. The next thing I wanted to do was I want a new section called Community Corner. And I think that it's a goal of mine is to build a stronger community through stitching. And, you know, the more that I've read about stitching and making with your hands and the benefits of doing that, I think that in today's day and age, you really need to encourage people to make as much as possible, whether that be stitching or baking or gardening or carving, I mean, whatever you would like to do. So I want to add a section called Community Corner. And in this section, I would like to talk about something that is beneficial with stitching and community, good things people are doing in the community with respect to stitching. And a part of my haul this time, I had ordered something from Avlea Folk Embroidery, I think it's called, and it came in this really, really beautiful package. But what I want to share from her in this community corner is when I had opened up this bag, sorry about that, she had a card in here, and I thought, oh, this is really, really cool. And so I'll just share this with you guys, and I'm going to post all this information in the drop down box in case it's something you would like to contribute to personally. It says, here at Avela, I like to support crafting and wellness. I am now partnering with Help Heal Veterans, a charitable organization that teaches veterans to craft as a therapeutic tool. And I talked about this in our episode 7 as well. It says you can learn more about their work at www.healvets.org. The therapy is not in a bottle, is their theory. And stitching can help promote healing from PTSD and other mental health issues, as well as improve overall wellness. But they need craft supplies, and that's where Avela comes in. You can help use, and the mailer she sent was reusable, so you can use your reusable mailer that your order arrived in, label it, and send craft donations to Help Heal Veterans. Some items that are especially appreciated are, I'll put a picture in here while I'm reading this so you guys can screenshot it, okay? Hoops, whether that be plastic or wood, any sizes needed, needles of any kind, new or used, counted thread fabric, whether that is Ada or even weave. I'm sure you could send linen, whatever you would like. Floss, embroidery scissors, needle minders, magnifying glasses like the readers, and any used patterns you have for cross stitch or embroidery. And then there is the ship to as well, their ship to Help Heal Veterans. And that's in Winchester, California. And I'll put all that in the drop down box. But I thought, so first of all, I ordered this really amazing stuff I'll share with you guys. But how cool is it to see that this company, she sends us out with all of her stuff. So not only is she, you know, she's done good business for herself, but she's promoting that sense of community and also helping to, you know, heal and facilitate healing for PTSD for veterans in the United States, which I think is absolutely amazing. So I will be sending them something. I encourage you guys to do the same. Just pop something in the mail. You know, it doesn't have to be fancy. It doesn't have to be silks or anything crazy. But if you have something you want to pop down there, send it to them. If you even have a little kit that you're, you know, you were going to use and you're not going to, or those little Mill Hill Christmas kits, anything, just send it. They'll love it. And if you can even kit up something, I'm sure that's even better. So I think that was really, really cool. I will definitely attach the information to the side for anyone who's interested in that. Now the next thing I wanted to do is something that is new as well for me, and it's inspired by, I had to write her name down, Phoebe with Moonshine Stitchery, which is such a clever name. So I was drawn to one of her videos because she has joined our Year of the Dragon cell, and I watched her most recent video, and this girl, she does all the things. She has so much fun. So she stitches, but she also has a special nail polish line. She, you know, talks about film and literature. She talks about music. She has vlogs. She's very, very fun. But one of the things she does, and I thought, oh, I need to do that, is she uses a spinning wheel to decide what she's going to stitch on next. And it looks like this. You guys, I was gonna do this on my phone and I realized I'm filming on my phone, so that's not going to work. So I had to put it on my iPad. But here you can see, these are all the things. Oh, and you can see the reflection of my light that I have that are either whips or new starts that are kitted up and ready to roll. So the really cool idea is that, you know, she would spin her wheel and essentially pick her next project she's gonna work on for the next couple weeks. And so I thought that's really, really neat, because I do find sometimes I'm like, what should I stitch on next? I'm not particularly motivated for anything, then I start something new. And so I thought that this could be a really cool way to kind of help work through some of those whips. And yeah, just get things rolling, right? So I don't know what I'm going to call this little segment, but right now I'm thinking like select a stitch or something. I don't know. If you guys have a suggestion, definitely leave a comment with a suggestion of some sort of, you know, catchy phrase or something like that. It'd be really cool. So I thought we could spin that together and just see where it lands on what I'll be working on. I can't read backwards. Oh, Newcastle Bouquet Biscornu. So this is actually really cool. This is a, I'll put a picture in. It's a Teresa Coget Biscornu. And I had started my very first one with Modern Folk Embroidery, and I haven't finished it quite yet. But I'll be starting this one over the next couple weeks, and I'll share with you guys where I'm at in about 2 weeks' time on that one. So it's really exciting, something new for me to start. Not that I needed that, but it'll be good. And then the next thing I wanted to do as well was our giveaway. So our last video, I celebrated a finish with Treasure Island by Owl Forest Embroidery. And I had made a bag for myself that I had used throughout the term of the project. And I'm no longer using it. There's a bag at the back here, like a liner where you can keep your pattern as well. And I'm no longer using this. So I thought what I would do is actually give it away to a viewer that may be working on Treasure Island or a pirate themed cross stitch. And I did use a random comment picker. I'll put a picture in here. The winner is, I'm not sure the pronunciation, Jans 9476. So if you can please email me, my email is in the description box. It's fibersandfloss@gmail.com. I'll get that out to you. And if you can also let me know if you want the leftover thread from Owl Forest Embroidery. If you do, I'll pop that in the mail for you as well. I don't really have a ton of other things to share. I normally, I've got a couple little things of haul, and then I do have some knitting, but I don't think I'm going to share my knitting today. I'm almost done my second sock, and so I'm going to save my February socks for my next video. I'll go over haul. I want to talk about Nashville Market a little bit, and then that's it. We can wrap it up. So for haul, I did order, I placed an order through 123 Stitch for just some various, you know, I'm doing Teresa Wensler's, two of them. So I need like 200 needles, because the theory with the Wensler's is that you kind of keep a needle with your working thread and you end up with all of these ones. And because it's a lot of confetti stitching as well. So you could either, I guess, park your thread, or you could keep it separate on a needle. And that's what I've been doing. So I've ordered some new needles. I also was out of, almost completely out of white, and also the B5200 and 310, like a couple really basic stuff. So that's all kind of boring. But then I did order this pattern from the Artsy Housewife, and it's called Pretty Bird. It's super cute. I thought it'd be really fun to stitch this one, and then whether I finish that into like a project bag of some sort. The count is only 90 by 158 stitches, and it is stitched, I'm reading the back while I'm talking to you, I'm cheating a little bit, using all DMC floss, so super easy to kit up. And it's stitched on 32 count straw by Weeks Dye Works, and unfortunately they were out of the straw, but I will probably still order it because I do like the color. I also do like a couple of the Artsy Housewife upcoming releases as well for Nashville. And so I think that I really like that Geraldine, the bear with the flowers off her head. And so I think that I'll probably order enough straw, I could do a couple. So that's one piece of haul. The other one was that Avela Folk Embroidery. Bear with me. This was beautiful. I'll insert a couple photos. When I opened it, everything is packaged in this lovely paper, and it is cross stitch, although she calls it embroidery, and it comes with, I can't show you a picture because all I have is the pattern. Oh, hold on. I can show you this. So this is what it is. It goes underneath like your, I don't know what you call it. You know, people used to put like doilies under things and stuff like that. It's like that. But it's a very, I wouldn't say it's a runner because it's small. You know, it's all in all, I think it's 14 inches by 18 inches is the finished size. And I thought that's really neat for a couple reasons. So first of all, you notice the hem stitch on there. And ever since watching Cardamom Pins do her hem stitch on her, all her Jacob pieces, I want to learn to do that. I talked a little bit about the Selvage Edge as well and drawn thread method in Flosstubeversity number one, and doing a hem stitch is actually a form of drawn thread, so I have not done that. So this pattern will offer a couple really unique things I haven't done before, including the hem stitch. And it came with a kit with everything, so it has traditional ground cloth, which is 26 count, and it's pretty I don't know if it will focus there, pretty raw stuff. So that's that. And then this is the floss that it comes with. So I think that will be a really fun project, something different, you know. And I like that it came with all reusable packaging, everything's paper packaging, and of course her community connection as well, for veterans. I think that's really neat. And the last thing I wanted to talk to you guys about was Nashville Market. I want to know, what is your top thing on your list for Nashville? What is the one pattern so far? I mean, all the designers are still coming out with their stuff, right? And we've got a few weeks, but 2 weeks. But I've been watching a lot of Lindy's Stitches, and Lindy's Stitches, she's been doing her Nashville shopping list, I think she's calling it. And I think she's on to episode 7 now, where they are featuring, she's being picky with what she's choosing because you can't share everything, there's too much. But she is choosing a handful of designs from certain designers that they're carrying in the shop. And there's been quite an array of stuff that she has shared. So I'm curious to know what your guys' top picks are so far on your Nashville shopping list. And on my next video, I'm going to share my top 5 picks. Right now I have quite a few, I'd say probably 7 or 8 that I'm quite interested in doing. I will definitely order one. I don't know if I'll order more than that because I have so many things on the go, and I need to finish something before I can do that. So I'm just trying to keep my WIP number down, although I can definitely see how some people just, get that number really high. It'd be very easy to do. So let me know about your Nashville top picks. Also let me know if you know anybody in the stitching community, anything that's happening that people are doing that are really cool for people in their neighborhood. You know, things that you've heard, initiatives that are taking place that maybe we could help participate in, or initiatives that we can help instill in our own communities. And I think that's all I have to share with you. So until next time, thank you so much for watching, and I look forward to seeing you. Take care and happy stitching. Bye.